would this evening and turn to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 17, one of the most familiar, perhaps the most preached messages in all Scripture, that one concerning David and the Goliath giant that he comes up against. We know it all too well. This is the place where David was leaves out a victor, and he claimed the people sing of him and sing that he has slain his tens of thousands and Saul his thousands. He's a champion amongst men. David is a man that we can look up to and find strength in the Lord through his words. The Psalms are riddled with his ups and downs of life, but always pointing everyone to the cross. David's one that showed mercy to folks, and he is also demonstrated in Scripture as merely a man. Sometimes we lift up men and exalt them to positions and think so well of them, but we find David is just like other men. He sins in that he murders Uriah and the adultery that is committed with Bathsheba. It illustrates to us God's great mercy when God shows him grace and mercy even when he's committed these wicked sins. It shows a picture of God and his relationship to the people who live in this day and age as well. God looks for another. Leading up to this passage of Scripture, back in chapter 13, really, God's looking for another man. David is this man. Saul has done wicked. He's done evil. In verse 14 of 1 Samuel 13, it says, "But now thy kingdom shall not continue. The Lord hath sought him a man after his own heart. And the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee." And then it says in verse number 22 of the same, or in Acts 13, "And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said," this is what God says, "I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will." And so we're looking at this man and who he is and what's going on in this account we're so familiar with. But I believe tonight as we look at this story, there's something that we can take away that'll give us just a little bit more what we need to fight in this day and age of spiritual men and women as we stand against the wiles of the devil. This evening as we look at the story of David and Goliath, my attention's turned to one verse. Verse number 40. Where the Bible says, "And he took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag, which he had even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistines." And this evening, with the Lord's help, I want to speak to you on this. Pick out your stones. Let's pray. Father, we come to you now and ask your power upon this service. Give me an unction from on high, I pray, Lord God. May your will be done, for it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. My interest this day is in the stones that he finds in the brooks, these smooth stones. But as we come to this verse and we're going to make our way through the story, I want you to understand that what takes place in verse 40 is a result of the man who's standing before an entire army. He stands before this giant. This man has already a reputation that has preceded him. He's preparing for battle against what could be the very last day that Israel is a free nation. David's character, who David is what leads up to verse number 40. And I believe that we can leave out of here this evening strengthened by the Word of God if we'll first understand who David is and what's taking place here in this battle. I want to first of all point out, number one, David's concern. Look at verse 23, and because of the familiarity of the text and the what's going on here, we're not going to read through a bunch of verses. We are going to skip through just because of the familiarity. Verse number 23, the Bible says this, "And as he talked with them, behold, there came up a champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, out of the armies of the Philistines, and spake according to the same words, and David heard them." You see, David's concern starts right here. When he's returned here by command of his father to come down and check on his brothers, he's come down here to check and to bring gifts from his father to deliver them. And now his concern begins. My dear friends, the condition of this nation, the spiritual condition of many churches needs some people, some men who have a little bit of guts in them, some spiritual guts and fortitude that are willing to stand up and recognize there's a problem and get a concern. I think that the majority of the moral failures that are going on in the church this evening across this land and around the world are a result of people who are not concerned with anything other than their own life and their own conditions. My dear friends, David, his concern began what one man said to the armies of Israel whom he was not a part of. David's concern begins here. Under David's concern, I want you to see, first of all, his concern for his brothers, the brothers. Verse 22, in verse number 22, David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage and ran into the armor and came and saluted his brethren. You know, my dear friends, what I see going on in this nation is a complete and total destruction of the church and the Christian home, and the family unit is being utterly destroyed, and it's because there's a lack of concern. But most importantly, if we were to really narrow it down, there's a lack of concern for other brethren. The Bible tells us in Galatians 6:2, bear you one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. In Proverbs 27:17, the Bible says, iron sharpeneth iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friends. We need to get a concern about our brothers and sisters when they're in trouble, when they're going through pains and hardships, when they're going through trials in their life. It ought to be something, it ought not to be something too big for us to step out of our comfort zone and step into their lives and be willing to put an arm around them, or to help ease the burden. Maybe it's something financial. Maybe it's just putting your arm around them. Maybe it's spending some time talking to them. But there must first be a concern for the brethren. There's ladies facing depression all over this land. There's ladies facing all kinds of abusive situations and relationships. The Bible commands the elder ladies of the church, those senior saint ladies of the church, to help instruct those ladies in child rearing. It would be great to see churches with women who are concerned about other ladies' lives instead of holding up in their own home and only being concerned with where they're at. You see, David's about to do something mighty and something just so big that the world didn't even know what was about to happen. Under the conditions that were laid out, you know the story. Goliath says, if you beat me, we'll be your slaves. If we beat you, you'll be our slaves. I mean, all of Israel hinges on this very moment right now. And David's concerned. He's first of all concerned with his brothers. Second of all, I want you to see David's concern concerning the berating. Verse 26. The Bible says, and David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? David is now sitting here. He heard. We saw that back in verse number 23, where he heard Goliath saying this, and now he hears again the very words that Goliath is speaking, and now his concern is with the fact that other Christians are being, and I'm using that as an example, obviously they're Israelites, but other Christians are being berated by the world. We ought to get concerned tonight that there are people attacking Christians, brothers and sisters in churches. We'll pray just a moment ago concerning the division that some people have, and there's some fighting going on. Thank God it's not in this church, and may it never be in this church. But my dear friends, there's a lot of berating going around. There's a lot of hatred and attack on the Christian culture right now in America. You know what the Bible says in 1 Peter 3:9? Not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called that ye should inherit a blessing. We must be careful that we don't respond the wrong way. See, David at this moment could respond the wrong way. I mean, he could get agitated. He could start mouthing off to these soldiers that are standing there who are supposed to be fighting the fight, and he could have caused disunity to take place. But rather, he listens and he thinks about what needs to be done. He realizes that there's brothers and sisters around him who are weak and in need of his strength. Romans 12, 17 through 21, the Bible says, recompense to no man evil for evil, Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth within you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, thus saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in doing so, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcomer of evil, but overcome evil with good. You see, David is listening to this berating, and his response is going to be important to what's going on. I'm leading you somewhere. I'm bringing you to verse number 40. So listen closely as we continue on. I want you to notice next that David's concern, not only with his brothers, not only with the berating, but in verse 28, we find his concern with the boasting. Verse 28 through 30, the Bible says, and Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why comest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and the naughtiness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. And David said, what have I now done? Is there not a cause? And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. Here David comes and he says and he listens. He says, wait a minute, guys, don't we serve the living God? I mean, isn't the God of Israel the very God who parted the Red Sea and conquered the Egyptian army when the water swept over top of them? He says, what are you guys doing sitting up here? Don't you know you have the power of Almighty God behind you? Get down there and fight and run this enemy away. And what happens is his own brothers turn to him, and it says Eliab's anger was kindled against him. You know what we got going on in this country and in churches right now and Christians, within family, is people are looking at other people saying, listen, don't get so gung-ho about serving God. Stop judging me, and I don't want to be judged. You leave me alone. Quit heaping things on top of me. Why don't you just be quiet and stay over there? My dear friends, what we need is some concern for the spiritual condition of the Christians in this land. The boasting that takes place by David is not one where he boasts of himself. Let me tell you what the Bible says, okay? For those people out there who are saying that we're too gung-ho and boy, we're out there door knocking. You're always doing something. Can't you slow down? Quit judging everybody out there. Listen, friend, the judgment is this, that if you don't repent and get saved, you're going to hell. And our cry ought to be louder than their cry. And it's not boasting that we are saved and going to heaven. Listen to what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13 through 18. But we will not boast of things without our measure. But according to the measure of the rule which God hath distributed to us, a measure to reach even unto you. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure as though we reach not unto you. For we are come as far as to you also in preaching the gospel of Christ. Not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other men's labors, but having hope, when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you according to our rule abundantly, to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you, and not to boast in another man's line of things made ready to our hand, but he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord, for not he that commendeth himself is approved, but whom the Lord commendeth. The Lord's commending David before these men here. He's showing them that David is in fact a spiritual giant, and he is willing and ready to serve and to lead them. See, Saul has already messed up. God's removing Saul, and this is God's way of lifting up David before the men. Can I tell you tonight that there's some people that don't want to go soul winning, and they're always making comments about others who do go soul winning and see people saved. It's not wrong to be joyful in how many souls you are leading to the Lord. We ought to, as a church, be exciting, really provoking each other to good works, pushing each other to serve God more faithfully and to get out there and soul win and to point people to Christ, show people where they can go to be built up in the faith. But there's some that'll attack that. There's some that they'll say, oh, what's going on over there? Watch out for that. Don't listen to that. I already hear things about people, what people say about me. I got too much zeal and too much fire, and I'm always going. I need to slow down. I'm out there trying to get people saved, and they attack me for repentance. They attack me because I don't believe in easy believism, and I try to show people slowly what the Bible says. I get attacked for whatever I do. Can I tell you something, though? I'm going to boast in the Lord that he's saving souls and he continues to do it. That's what David's doing here. He's telling them, listen, our God's delivered us. He's done great things. Put your trust in God and watch God do what he does. Let God do what he does. I'm trying to move quickly because I've got a lot of points and it's a Wednesday night. Amen. We see, first of all, David's concern. Let's get to number two, David's commitment. David's commitment. In verse number 32, we find David's commitment. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight with the Philistine. I want you to notice, first of all, concerning David's commitment, he is always running. He is always running. Now, I don't suppose it was too long back that I preached a message on that, concerning that running as David runs or something along those lines. But look back in verse number 17. The reason he is running all the time, every time you find him in Scripture, is because in verse number 17, his father tells him, he says, and run, the last part of 17, and run to the camp to thy brethren. Then we find in verse number 20, he wakes up and he's running. He rose up early in the morning and left with the sheep of the keeper and took and went. That word rent there, he's going quickly. He's moving fast. In verse number 22, and David left his carriage, and the Bible says halfway down, and ran into the army. And then in verse number 48, we find again David running towards Goliath. David's always running. He's always getting after it as fast as he can. He's serving God. He's got purpose in his life. You know, David's commitment comes because he's got some purpose in his life. Oh, that we could get some Christians with some purpose in their life. They'd get committed to something because they'd have a purpose to do it. Sometimes we go about this Christian life with no purpose, no concern. There's nothing in us. There's nothing that drives us. Oh, but friends, when you taste of soul winning, when you get to see that person come to the Lord, you get overexcited about it. It's all you can think about. I long for the next person that comes to know Christ as their Savior, or the next person who's backslid that turns their attention back to God. That's what I pray every day, asking God to let me see someone else. And boy, I'm telling you, it's something that comes over me when I go through these droughts, when people aren't getting saved or people aren't turning back and I'm not having any effect. I find myself of no value. I feel like I'm not doing anything. That's the commitment that David has. That's why he's always running. He's always ready to serve God. Hebrews 12:1 tells us, wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand and throne of God. In 1 Corinthians 9:24, the Bible says, know ye not that that which you run in a race, run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that you may obtain. You know what God's saying? He's saying, listen, why don't you get committed about this thing and put some purpose in your steps and get running and hurry up and do what you're supposed to do? You can spend your whole life fighting against God and going here and going there and doing nothing for God. My dear friend, you'll never see the results that David sees. But David is always running. Secondly, I want you to notice that David's always ready. David's always ready. Verse 34, verse 35, we find that the Bible says, and David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote them and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by the beard and smote him and slew him. He always is ready for whatever's coming. As a shepherd out in the wilderness, it's one thing to be ready for a wolf that may creep in and come, and you can kind of see him coming from a distance, and that's what that sling was for, so that he could fling it and drive away the wolves. But for a lion and a bear, this young man was always ready to fend the flock. I mean, he'd take off after him. The Bible says he grabbed him, and then when the lion jumped up, he grabbed him by his beard and slew him. That's a boy with some guts right there. He's one that was committed to doing what God had tasked him with, keeping those sheep. None were going to get out of his hand as long as he lived. That's a man who was always ready. You know, in this story, we find that same man always ready. He didn't come down there with just the cheese and the things that his father told him to deliver. No, the Bible tells us in verse number 40 that he came down there with the staff, the sling, and his script. Colossians 4:6, the Bible says, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. 1 Peter 3:15, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of your hope that is in you with meekness and fear. And in Psalms 119:42, so shall I have wherewith to answer him that reproacheth me, for I trust in thy word. Are you prepared tonight? Are you ready for the encounters that you'll have with the people outside these walls? Are you ready for those people that come to you with problems saying, why is it that you believe in that God? And tell me about him. Are you ready all the time? My dear friends, what's leading up to this moment in verse number 40 is a man who's not only committed, but a man who is always running and always ready. I want you to notice number 3, David's choice. And this is really the point that I was driving to get to quickly. David's choice. He didn't just take the first thing that came his way. He didn't just take any stones. Look at verse number 40. It says, and he took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook. Stones, number one, I want you to notice David's choice. He chose stones that formed in the brook. We're talking about pick out your stones tonight. Pick out your stones. David chose stones that were picked out of the brook. And you say, well, that's obvious. It's right there in Scripture. Yeah, but sometimes you got to read it and think about it and meditate upon it. And then you realize that they're both standing and hiding behind rocks. They're on hills. They're on mountains. On both sides, there are rocks there all about them. And on his way down, he could have very easily picked up any rock along the way. He might have passed along something that, boy, that one right there, that'll strike real well. Maybe he found some Indian heads, arrowheads there. He could have, boy, this one would be good to fling. That's a joke there. You can lighten up. But he's choosing to go down to the brook and choose the stones that are in the brook. Now that's important, and that's what jumped out to me in this story. What's important about that is he didn't just want any stones. He wanted the smooth stones that were in the brook. What's down in the brook is the stones that were made smooth by the current which drags them through the water. They beat everything that they pass, and everything that passes them beats against them. Before too long, they're made into smooth stones that are strong and usable. See, he knew that he could pick up any rock, and all those little jagged edges on it, they may catch on that sling. When they hit things, because of the angles and the edges, it would cause pressure and it would fracture the rock, thus rendering the rock less useful than the smooth stones that are down in the brook. David knew what he needed was stones that were going to get the job done. His attention was turned to the stones that were in the brook, and that's where he was going to get the stones that he needed to fight this battle with. In Psalms 27:14, the Bible tells us this, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. He found stones that were formed in the brook. I want you to notice, secondly, he found stones that fit in the bag. Stones that fit in the bag. His bag was undoubtedly smaller than Goliath's. His bag wasn't unfamiliar to him. You see, when he went down there to choose those 5 stones, Brother Gary, he knew that he needed stones that were going to fit into his bag, not into someone else's bag. And can I tell you tonight, by way of application, that we need to be looking at this life and the things in our own life, the troubles and trials that we're going to face, and our condition, our work conditions, and our financial conditions, and our family conditions. We need to be choosing stones that are going to fit into our bag. You see, there's Christians out there that are always studying, and that's a good thing, but sometimes they go studying things that they don't need to be worried about. It has no pertaining to their current situation, and they're struggling, and they're falling flat on their face because they're not focused upon the thing that's right before them. We need to pull out the stones that fit in our bag. David went down there, and he chose out 5 stones. Now, if he would not have been thinking clearly, he might have just gone down to the brook. Maybe on his way down there, he realized, you know what, the stones in the brook, those are smooth stones. Those are going to do better because they're smooth. They're going to be stronger. They're not going to break when they hit. They're going to do what I need them to do, and they're going to have a bigger surface area. He could have gone all the way down there, but then he could have been distracted by the Goliath in front of him. By the chants of the soldiers upon the hill, they could have been chanting out and laughing and mocking at the little boy that's making his way down to fight their great warrior, this giant of a man, Goliath. And in his distraction, he could have maybe grabbed stones that were too big. He could have grabbed big stones that didn't fit in his bag, or just three stones that were just a little too big and too heavy. But no, he chose five smooth stones. I believe when he was down there in that brook, as he began looking at those stones, he began to think about all that God could do with that little stone. And boy, that one right there, that's one that'll fit. That'll fit right between his armor plates. Where's God? I don't know where God's going to have me throw this just yet, but I'm going to get that one right there. I'm going to be prepared because I don't know how he's going to come at me. Now, we read the story sometimes as though these two people came down to the bottom and they looked at each other, and Goliath raised his sword up and laughed, and then David threw the stone. But the Bible tells us that David ran, and it says that Goliath drew near. So there was evidently some approaching going on, and in David's mind, there had to be some kind of distractions taking place. And as he's picking out and choosing those stones, he's making sure that he's got what he needs for the distance that he needs them to cover, and they're going to hit the target precisely where he needs them to hit. David is very intently inspecting the stones in the brook. And he's going to choose those stones that fit into his bag. Not anyone else's bag, his own bag. I want you to notice, thirdly, Philippians 4:19, the Bible says, "But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." He's going to supply everything you need if you're careful to make sure you get what you need in your possession. Before I go to the third point, subpoint here under David's choices, let me say this. There are some people that they're always going through life. Boy, they're just, it's just haphazardly. Everything works for the good. God's going to work everything out to the good. Yeah, but the rest of that verse says to those that love him. And it goes on to tell us, and according to his word, it's to those people who are serving him. It's not just for anybody who just haphazardly goes through life and crashes at every turn they take. The promises of God have conditions attached to them. If you do this, I'll do this. And so that's the intention that David had in that brook. He was finding stones that were going to purpose in his life. They were going to, each one of those stones that he was choosing had a very distinct and important directive. He knew that that stone had to perform whatever the task was in front of him. He wasn't just going about this. The Bible tells us what I just read there in Philippians 4:19. God will supply all your needs. You know what those needs come through? They come from putting ourselves in front of good, solid Bible preaching and teaching, Bible study at home, a prayer life. You can't expect to have a relationship with God when you never talk to God. You can't ever have a relationship with God when you don't ever let him talk to you through the reading of God's word and through the preaching of God's word. That relationship has to be established. Then he can supply all our needs. He gives us a promise he'll supply all our needs, but the condition is, there has to be a relationship. He finds those stones that fit in his bag. I want you to know, thirdly, David's choice. He chooses stones that flew in the direction thrown. See, rough stones, as I've already mentioned, they're jagged edges. Those edges catch and break. They really, if you take a rock that's just all kinds of holes and things sticking out of it, and you try to roll it, what it does is it bounces, and I've tried this, so I know it bounces and topples and tumbles every which way. It has no clear direction. Those stones on the mountains, they hadn't been pushed down the water of the brook. They hadn't gone through that process of smoothing out the rough edges. Had he chosen those stones when he began to spin his sling around, and as he whipped that sling and released it, those jagged edges could very well caught into the leather, and as it began to throw, it could have thrown down into the ground and just bounced around. It could have flung off into any direction. There was no surety of those rough stones that were there. They snag anything they come in contact. The rough stones aren't good for throwing. Isaiah 11, chapter 11, verse 2 through 4, "The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. Talking about Jesus here, but my dear friends, that's the one who fights our battles. And the what we're talking about here is David makes some wise choices. I'm talking this evening to some mamas who are raising young children, who are trying to set up some direction for their young children. And you can go about trying to entertain children with television. Those are the rough stones. They'll get the job done for a moment. But my dear friends, when it comes time for them to stand before a trial in their own life, they'll have nothing of surety for their own stance. They'll have nothing to be able to stand upon those rough stones. They may get the job done, but it's a highly unlikely chance that it'll get it done the right way. I'm talking to some daddies this evening that have some young boys that are growing up, or some young girls that are growing up, and they're trying to set a standard, and they're trying to work hard to provide. Can I tell you something this evening? That work can get in the way, and it can keep you from serving God, and it can keep you from influencing your children for some godly examples, some godly fathers who are leading them in the right way. That Bible study, that end of the night prayer time, whatever it is, I'm talking to some daddies tonight. Listen, you can choose some smooth stones, or you can choose some rough stones, and they both can, you can put them in the sling, and you can both use both of them to try to throw it down range. But listen to me, friends, each one of them is going to have a different outcome. One is sure as fire, one is proven to be true, one will always make them to raise up. The Bible says, bring your children up in the admonition of the Lord, raise them up in the admonition of the Lord. And the Bible tells us to raise them up in the way they should go, in the direction they should go, and when they're old, they will not depart from it. That's the smooth stones. Friends, listen to me. Tonight I'm talking about David's choices. I'm trying to help you tonight. Pick out your stones. Pick out your stones. We're in a fight every day, a spiritual giant before us each and every day. It used to be like once a year, once a month, once a week. Now it's every day. It's almost every hour. We're in this great spiritual battle. I mean, it seems like everything's falling apart. Every moment, every step you take, it's like this could be the last one. I could mess up bad this time. Never before have we been faced with such evil. I mean, the days are evil. I mean, like nothing else. You know what I'm talking about. You turn on the television for 2 minutes and you just see the wickedness and the evil that's taking place. You got to choose out your stone. Pick out your stones. Don't pick out the rough stones. Don't take the easy ones. See, the easy ones where David was up there, he could have picked out a stone before he ever arrived on the battlefield. He could have taken the easy way out, but he chose to go down there in the brook closer to the enemy. He presented himself weak to the enemy as he bent over. At that moment, David could have taken that gigantic spear the Bible tells us about. He could have brought it back in his arm, and he could have thrown the spear and killed David as he picked out those stones. But you know what? It was more important for David to do the right thing. It took a little more work. It took a little more time. It took a little more faith and a little more trust. But he went down there and picked out the stones. David gets in that brook and make sure he has what he needs to fight this battle. Can I tell you this evening, as I was mulling over this and thinking about this, considering as he's getting ready for this fight, picking out the right stones had everything to do with this fight. It had nothing to do with what took place before where he got all gung-ho. I mean, is there not a cause, he said? I mean, you guys are up here on the mountain, and this guy's down here running his mouth. I mean, let's go down there and sock him in the mouth, one good one. No, David had to take his time. I mean, if it was me and somebody's over there running his mouth, I'm coming down there pretty quick. David does the right thing. He slows down. Wait a minute, I need God in this. I'm going to take my time, though I could pick up. You know, the truth of the matter is, where the location was, he could have picked up one of those stones up there on the mountain. He could have stayed up there flinging them at Goliath all afternoon. Maybe one of them would have hit home. You know, sometimes that's what we try to do. We're throwing a little Bible study over here. We're throwing a little prayer time over here. We'll get them to church over here. We'll do little things here and there. But my dear friends, that's not enough for this day. That's not enough for this giant. For the giant that's ahead, for the battle that's raging around us right now, that's not enough. We're going to have to go down into the fight. We're going to have to go down there and choose us out some stones that are going to be fit for the job. David goes down and he's going to make a choice. And tonight, if you're in that battle, or you're observing that battle, listen, it's not just for mama and daddies with young children. The battle's continuous. There's people, some of you older ladies that have been saints of God for so many years, and some of you older men have been saints of God for years. There's young men and women in this building, and they're counting on you to direct them, to help them, to teach them, so that they know how to fight the battles you've already fought. They're going to need you. They're trusting in you. Your fight, you need to make sure now that you're going down to that battle. It's a new day, a new fight, and you're going to have to choose out some new stones for those new fights. The conditions change. But you still, your choice must always be a smooth stone or the rough stone. I want you to notice, fourthly, David's cry. Look at verse number 45 as we continue on here. We'll be done in just a moment. Verse number 45, then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts and the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. David's cry. First of all, he's looking at Goliath, and he says, listen, this is your way. You're trying to do things your way. And boy, and we could echo that tonight. The preacher's crying to you tonight. Quit doing it your way. Quit taking the easy way. Quit trying to do this thing your way. Trust God. Trust God. Your way is swords and spears and shields. That's what's listed there. That's what he says. You come at me, thou comest at me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. 2 Corinthians 10:4 tells us this, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. David says, first of all, listen to me, you're trying to do this your way. That ain't going to get it done in this fight. He didn't come down there to fight a physical battle, and he knew it from the moment he stepped foot off that mountain. He knew good and well that this battle was a battle against good and evil. It was against God and that Philistine who thought he was God. He said, listen, your way just ain't going to cut it. You're coming at me with swords and spears and shields. Look at me, here I am. I ain't got any of that on. I don't need any of that because this isn't a physical battle. And I'm trying to tell you tonight that some of us Christians have been trying to do things in their own ability, in their own power. They're trying to make provision for the family. I've seen people, and listen, I was right there. I did it for so long. My wife could tell you that it's the truth. I try to work lots of hours. There was a time I worked 7 days a week for week on end, trying to, boy, I was going to provide good for my family. You know what I found out real quickly? That when I was tithing and giving to missions and faith promise and giving more to God than I'd ever given before, I didn't have to work even half those hours, and I was better off than I was working all those hours. I'm trying to tell you tonight that you can do it your way, or you can do what David says, number two, Yahweh. You can do it your way, or you can do it Yahweh. Hey man, you say, what are you talking about? Yahweh is that term that's too sacred to be spoken. It's that term for God. That means a personal relationship. It's that personal God. He's not just the God of daddy and mama. He's not just the God that you go to worship on Sunday and Sunday morning. He is the God of your life, that one whom you have a relationship with. That's who Yahweh is. And David comes to this fight saying, listen, you can do it your way. I'm going to do it Yahweh. Yahweh's going to do this. It's not in me. I don't have the fight. He said, I'm just a youth. As Saul pointed out to him, he said, you're just a youth. That man over there has been a warrior since his youth. He's been doing this a long time. You stand no chance. He said, it's not about that. You don't understand. I'm not doing this. I'm not in this fight. I'm just the means in which God's going to fight this evil off. Can I tell you this evening that your cry ought to be the same cry? It ought to be the cry for Yahweh to step into your life. David is saying that he isn't in the battle, and the battle is not against him, but it's against his God. Can I tell you what's going on in this country tonight? It's not a battle against you or me. It's a battle against God. It's a battle against good and evil. It's a battle that the evil is trying to overcome the good that this nation has done. The battle that's before us, that's going on, is not one that you and I can fix, but it's one that Yahweh can fix. But you're going to have to know him to call upon him. Ephesians 6:12, the Bible says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." In Zechariah 4:6, the Bible says, "Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, This is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts." In Exodus 15:3, we find these words, "The Lord is a man of war, the Lord is his name." David's cry was not that I'm going to do this. He didn't give himself a big hoo-ah and charge down to the war. No, my dear friends, he decided right then and there that this was God's fight and he was going to do it God's way. I'm trying to tell you tonight that you got to pick up and pick out your stones. You're going to have to choose how you're going to fight these battles before you and how you're going to fight the battles that are before your children. You're going to have to choose to pick out either smooth stones or rough stones. You can give in on their dress standards. You can give in on their television time and the programs that they're watching and the games they're playing. But listen to me, if you give in too much, you're giving rough stones. You're choosing out, you're picking out rough stones. And down the road, when they needed you to fight that giant with the smooth stone, they're going to be faced with something you can't take back. Israel's facing this challenge right here. Listen to me. Israel is on the brink of complete slavery again. They're about to be done for. I'm talking the Philistines are going to rule and everything's going to change from this point on. The choice is in one man's hands because the rest had already given up. They were ready. They were surrendered. They were so surrendered. Have you ever considered the fact they were so surrendered that they sent a boy to do their work? I'm talking about warriors. I'm not talking about some little game of pool or ping pong or basketball. I'm talking about war. They sent a child to determine their fate. And I could say that there's some churches today that are doing the same thing. They're bowing down on their standards because they want to reach the younger generation. You know what I determined a long time ago? You know how I determined I'm going to reach the younger generation? The Word of God. Because the Word of God never changes. God's Word's the thing that's going to save them. God's Word's the thing that's going to change their life. I don't care what they think they need or what kind of music they think they need in church. It'll never change here because it's all about the Word of God and doing it God's way. I don't need to bend on that stuff. I don't need to move on that stuff. People say COVID is hurt a lot of churches, and it has. You know what I found out, though? The Bible says this. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And what we're finding is there's a lot of Christians and a lot of preachers and a lot of spiritual leaders that don't have faith in God. I choose to trust God. And it's not about whether he's going to grow the church building. It's about whether he's going to grow his eternity. He's going to grow heaven. The Bible says that he's not willing that any should perish. And so if that's the case, until the moment he comes down and calls his church out of this earth, that means that people will still get saved by this word. You must pick out your stones. That's what I'm trying to help you tonight. I want you to notice, fifthly, David's cast. David's cast. You know, like you cast the fishing pole. David cast that stone. I want you to notice that David's cast. And verse number 49 is where we find this. I'll be done. I'm almost done. We're closing in here. David put his hand in his bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. By the way, I'll just say this. This is the message I was working for on Sunday. God would not let me get away from this verse. I about drove myself crazy today. I put my head on the desk and said, God, I can't do this. You're driving. I'm ready to preach this on Sunday. I don't know what God wanted this preached tonight. I'm telling you, I had another message working. Brent walked in. I said, I just deleted the whole thing. This one's got to be preached. David's cast, I want you to notice, first of all, David's cast started in his hand. Started in his hand. The Bible says right there, and David put his hand in his bag. Ecclesiastes 9:10 tells us, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with all thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. What are you saying? I'm saying this, my dear friend. Do what you're able to do now while you still can. Time's almost up. You may never have another opportunity to win that person that you've been trying to win to the Lord, but you gave up on. You may never get another opportunity. That battle that you're facing right now, I'm talking about picking out your stones. That battle that you're facing right now, that you're about to give in. I mean, this battle's been going on for a long time, and maybe a couple years now. You're getting tired of that fight. You're just about to give in and compromise. Listen to me. Pick out your stone. It starts with the hand. His hand could have chose something that would have turned out very badly for Israel. Number two, strengthen in the heave. David's cast was strengthened in the heave. It wasn't about him. You understand that? It's not about us. It's about that we just keep pressing on. We just keep fighting. We just keep going at it. We don't quit. We just keep going. It may look like we lose. It may look like no matter how, I hear people talk about this election. I bring that up because it's fresh on our minds. Everybody, what's the point of voting? It doesn't matter anymore. Listen, I'm going to keep voting. And I'm going to keep fighting spiritual battles. Doesn't matter. It's in God's hand. Let's trust God. It says in Nehemiah 6:9, for they all made us afraid, saying, their hands shall be weakened from the work, that it be not done. Now therefore, O God, strengthen my hands. I believe every bit of me that when David was walking down there, he was talking almighty God. Lord, you see what I'm going up against? I trust you. They don't. I'm just going to keep on trusting you. I think he went down there with a smile on his face, just the way he did coming there. He was all excited and goes running into battle. I think he went into battle against Goliath that same way because he knew that God could and would do his bidding for him. Isaiah 59, 1 and 2, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is his ear heavy that it cannot hear. Is it good to know tonight that God still hears us and hears our cries even in the midst of our battles, even when it seems like all is lost? God still can hear us in that battle. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. Listen to me, friend. It starts in the hand, and it's strengthened in the heave. You got to be right with God before you throw those stones, before you choose those stones. Isaiah 41:13. For I, the Lord, Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. 2 Corinthians 12, verse number 8 and 9. The Bible says, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. I want you to notice, thirdly, David's cast sunk in the head. It sunk in the head. It started in the hand. It strengthened in the heave, and it sunk in the head. Psalms 119:11, thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Psalms 40, verse 8, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. The law of his God is in his heart. None of his steps shall slide. Hebrews 2, 1 and 2, verse 1 through 3. Therefore, we ought to give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? What am I saying tonight? I'm saying this. You must choose to serve God. You must guard your mind. You must use the stones that you choose is either going to defeat you or it's either going to help strengthen you and cause you to stand. And it's the Word of God in our hearts and our minds. That's the stones you're picking out. You're going to have to choose the walk with God. You're going to have to choose to memorize that scripture, because when the fight comes, it's the sword of the Lord that defeats the enemy. It's the sword of the Lord. And that's where the Christian is weakened today. That's where the Israelite was weakened on the hill. They forgot the Word of God. They forgot that he'd keep them. They forgot that he'd strengthen them. They forgot that he'd fight for them. They forgot all the promises of God Almighty. They stood on the hill without the Word of God in their mind. They stood already defeated. But David went down, and by the Word of God, he struck him in the head. Look back at verse number 45. I'll show you what it says. Halfway down it says, but I come to thee, now watch this, in the name of the Lord. And you today can go everywhere in the name of the Lord. Christian, Christ with you, in the Lord, in the name of the Lord. The very term Christian is that God is in you. that you're a disciple of God, that you're a follower of God, it ought to strike fear. The reason the evil hate the Christian so much is because they hate the name of Christ. They despise that name of Christ. And that name is the most powerful name. It's the very name that caused the men that came to take Jesus away and crucify him. They fell back at his name. The power that's in the name of the Lord. And our final point tonight is a quick last little dab here. David's conquest. Talking about pick out your stones. Pick out your stones. And you can have that same conquest. You can have that same conquering tonight in your life. And you can see the same conquest in your children's life. I don't know about you, but I'm not concerned about me. I'm concerned about my children. I can only imagine, I was talking to my mother earlier today about where television has gone over the last 20 years. And she made this comment that I was thinking, how can you even imagine, it's not even imaginable, how far and how wicked it'll be in 20 years from now. If the things that are available on television and available on movies and available on the screen on your phone and the computer, can you imagine how wicked it's going to be? Verse 50 and 51. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling, with a stone, and smote the Philistine and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran, there he is running again, and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath thereof and slew him and cut off his head therewith. And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled. David's conquest started in action. Back in verse 20, when he rose up early, the Bible says he rose up early in that verse, and then it says, and left and went. Three different times you find action taking place in David's life. It's high time you defeat the giants in your life. But you're going to have to pick out some stones. You're going to have to get busy, get moving. Stop sitting around and waiting for God to deliver you. God doesn't deliver the slothful. No, God uses men and women to do his work and do his bidding. And so long as we're active and moving forward, God will strengthen us and God will guide us. He started in action. He obeyed. John 18:11, the Bible says, Jesus said to Peter, put up thy sword into thy sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? Talking about picking out your stones tonight. You have a cup that's been given to you in your life. God's allowed some conditions, and a lot of times it's choices that we make that lead us to that place, to that cup. It's choices that we made, maybe bad choices back here in the past that have led us to the circumstance in front of us. But God has nonetheless given us that cup to drink. And now as Christians, ones who are walking with God, we get the choice of drinking that cup and letting God work through us regardless of how difficult the task is before us. We can choose the smooth stones and be able to fight in the power of God, or we can choose to fight against that cup that God gave us. And try to do it our way and try to just soften it a little bit and change it a little bit to make it a little more appealing to those around us or to the world or to our children. That compromise has destroyed quite a few. David's conquest started in action. David's conquest sought the Almighty. Verse number 45, it says, in the name. The Bible tells us in Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And then lastly, David's conquest stood in adversity. His conquest stood in adversity. How many times has something come up against you and you fall flat on your face? How many times has the trial come before you and you fall down and you feel like you're just getting defeated? You feel like no matter what's going on, you just can't win. You can't have victory. But Ephesians 6, in verse number 11, the Bible tells us, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. He goes on and throughout all that portion, the armor of God, you know it so well. He said, when you put that on, you'll be able to stand against all the fiery darts. Take up that shield of faith. Trust God. It's all about picking out your stones. You get to choose whether you fall or whether you stand. See, David had no thought in his mind when he went down there that he would fall. It wasn't a question. And I'm certainly not at that closing. Brother, if you'd come to the piano and go ahead and start playing. David's conquest, talking about picking out your stones. You know, I've my life I'm talking about. I know that I've not arrived and there's still a long way to go. But there's times in my life where I come to a place where I just trust God. And can I tell you, every single time, God showed himself faithful and strong. And it was a time going through it, but every time, God came through it. And he delivered me. But there's also been times where I kind of went into it questioning. The Bible talks about a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. When you think that you have faith, but you're doubting, it's not faith. And you're already picked out a rough stone. And the end is a terrible result. As you're picking out the stones for your battles ahead, you must choose out the smooth stones. Don't take the easy way out. Choose those things which are going to be needful in your fight. You cannot fight a battle and win without first picking up your stones. Pick out your stones and prepare wisely. God will fight the battles of those who are preparing and willing to prepare. Would you stand to your feet, every head bowed, every eye closed?